I knew instantly. I actually phoned the record company the next morning and said, I want to go in the studio because I think I know where we're going.
We just kind of clicked, really, when we started working together. And instead of doing just like 4 or 5 songs, we ended up doing 15 songs in 8 days.
If people can remember us playing all the small clubs when we first started off, you know, like that's a lot of the energy, like those performances are on this album.
It's quite aggressively chasing that record, which will make people sit up and take notice again, as if they were a fresh band just hitting the scene.
Lots of bands in their position who are on their 5th, 6th album are treading water. You know, they've got the guaranteed bankers, they know they're going to sell 1.5 million albums, and you just go to sleep. He clearly hasn't done that.
I was quite happy when people first heard it because nobody got it. And I thought, well, if half my family don't understand it and the record company didn't understand it at first, I thought maybe we're onto something.
One of Britain's biggest bands, Stereophonics, are at a creative crossroads. Known for their rousing drive-time rock, they're now pushing the pedal to the metal on a higher octane sound. Don't adjust your sets. Stereophonics are tuned to a new frequency, and the Sunday Times has been given exclusive access to the band rehearsing their latest album. We hear from all three members about what's changed and why their new Argentinian drummer has galvanized the group.
They've got a new Styx man in. They've got a relatively new sound. It's the sound of Kelly Jones caught between two impulses, one experimentation and the other caution. You know, he hasn't sold 7 million plus albums for no reason. And I'm just
although some of the sounds on the record are slightly different to where they've been before, the song structure, a classic, you know, sort of anthemic Kelly Jones songs, really, and his voice is still his voice, and that's always been an essential part of that band's makeup.
It came to April last year. There was a bit of free time in the schedule, and Kelly said it'd be a good idea if we go in just to see how, you know, like the songs would shape up for a new album.
The energy that was kind of happening between the three of us and Jim, the engineer, and Brad, the assistant, it was just kind of the five of us working in a studio, quite enclosed, and not thinking too much about that we were doing an album.
We knew that we can get the best out of each other if we went straight in there. No pressure from the record company, no pressure from anybody, because we didn't tell anyone.
On the last album, we had everybody in the studio. You know, girlfriends were there, everybody was there, and it was just kind of like a constant party, really. A bit of a booze up and everybody having a good time. We knew if we brought people in and they heard us messing around with drum loops and synthesizers and all that, they'd start going, what are you doing and all that, and then you'd stop kind of going there. So it was kind of good just to close the door.
Now he knows that he can do that, he can write the songs to support it. I think that's where you get great art. You know, you get your REMs, your U2s, those type of bands who really got an understanding of what they're generating. And yeah, I think he's doing a good job of that.
Watching Bowie and being on tour, it took us into a different place where we knew that you can just try and do anything you wanted to try, as long as, you know, like, it's not too far off the mark.
Although there's a lot of experimentation on this record, and there's different instruments and, you know, there's a lot more keyboards and things on it, I feel that maybe it's been written back as a really tight three-piece with a three-piece in mind.
I think we just mainly wanted to do something that was a lot more kind of up-tempo and a lot more energetic, really. You know, something that was just a lot more kind of current and relevant to what's going on at the moment, I think.
Every album we do, we want to try and push ourselves as far as musicians and as far as being in a band. Because, like we've always said, you're only as good as the last album.
I never want to repeat what we've done. if we kind of did four performances and cocktails, we'd get slagged off for that, and I don't want to do that. I'd rather piss people off and do an acoustic album and then do an album with dodgy keyboard ideas to some people, but to me, I like it.
It's trying to get everyone's attention to go, OK, don't sort of typecast this as being like this, because this sounds really new, and it does, you know, completely different to the last few albums.
It's a very dark album. It's almost like he's actually coming to terms with the fact that he maybe doesn't like the side of himself that actually just obsesses sometimes about people who've, you know, given him a hard time, or, you know, he's worked with and things haven't gone right, or whatever it is. And but, you know, as a journey inside his head, we get far further on this record than we've ever been before.
You're going to find quite a big change in lyrics, and that's due to the fact that the same person that is writing them has changed and has lived a lot of different experiences.
I think the lyrics change from record to record, really, and I think they pretty much mirror where and what I'm up to at that time in my life. Sometimes more in third person, and sometimes coming from me, you know. I don't think it's an overriding theme. I think only the first record kind of had an overriding theme, which was very much writing about small town rumours and characters, and certainly wasn't writing about anything of myself in that first record, because I'd never been anywhere and done anything, you know.
It's a song of wood gets old.
Word Gets Around is a more teenager kind of album. It was kind of more full-on, out there, just having fun. It's what they were going through at the time.
He looks like and sounded like the guy who'd sat on a tube or sat on the top deck of the bus watching people and, you know, wrote stories about the people that he saw. And, I mean, some of it was really what we used to call at the NME drudgery chic. I mean, just references to everyday, you know, boring nonsense. But somehow he managed to sort of, you know, piece all these images together.
There's something about the stories in those songs with the lyrics and especially once you've been to the village where the boys live, you realise the place is like a circus, you know? They should charge admission.
Carmarthen, their hometown, it is really a little coal mining town in Wales. It's small, you can see the hills, and everyone who walks in the street knows exactly who they are. You know, it's a very small, close-knit community.
I'm very, very proud where I come from, and that's kind of made me who I am, and that's what gives you your morals, your sarcasm, your wit, your anger. All that stuff is from growing up in Wales. But I'm not going to be working for, like, you know, the tourist board, saying where I'm from in every interview, because I don't think it's about that.
The Stereophonics will never get away from playing live to a huge audience holding a few Welsh flags, you know, that's going to follow them wherever they go. But for them, I don't think that Welsh thing is so important to be talked about all the time, and I think that's being lost a little bit now.
There was probably a time in the life of the Stereophonics where they were considered to be maybe, you know, a little parochial almost, you know, and that they would underachieve. But I think, you know, by album three, Kelly had left that behind. I think even by album two, he was thinking on a far, far bigger scale.
One of the things that's propelled him all the way along is this slightly pugnacious, pugilistic character who wants to get out, move on up.
Certainly this latest record sounds like a record which has America partly in mind.
With America, you know, like every band that puts records out, they've always got ambitions to, you know, like go out there and succeed, because it is such a big place for music, and a lot of the influence of bands you listen to, they've all, you know, like had roots in America.
If it
takes off quite well in the States and all of that, it will be great to actually do a really big kind of tour.
This more strung out, funkier, edgier, sparser rock sound is something that he knows is likely to play well in America, and he wants America.
I'm probably living my dreams right now. I mean, personally, I would say, because I always cherished and dreamt about being in the position I am now, being able to play with a band this big and being able to kind of tour around the world with your music.
You know, he's come from Argentina like 4 years ago, barely speak English, and ends up working in a studio in London. So you can just tell by just knowing that, that the guy doesn't just sit around his arse expecting things to come to him, he goes out and gets them. And that's what this band's about, really.
There's a lot of energy coming from Javi, and it's like any new person coming into any environment. They try and bring something with them that will give everybody else a boost.
Within the first hour of playing together, we felt really comfortable. Everything I did was in the same kind of wavelength they were in as well.
I think it's shaken them up in the studio, and I think, although he'd probably be the very worst person to try to ask to admit this, I think there was a sense of fatigue creeping in.
I've been friends with Stewart for like 25 years. We've been everywhere together, done everything together. And it just got to the point where Stereophonics, as more than a group, as a you know, quite a big collection of people who work for Stereophonics, whether it's crew or management or record company, we're putting a lot of time and energy into things, and the old management of Stewart wasn't really doing as much as that, you know. So we wanted to make some changes because everything was becoming very, very negative.
To be honest, I don't think it, you know, it mattered where the new drummer came from. It just mattered whether AE could play and whether he could fit in again. Kelly could actually go back to like writing a song for a tight-knit three-piece because they were all very much together. And you can imagine them in a rehearsal room bashing out new songs because they're all, you know, very excited by it, and it works. It's back as a unit.
I've just spent a whole day doing a photo shoot with them for the new campaign, and they just seemed really happy in the shots. You know, I'm not saying that they weren't when Stewart was there, but the dynamics between them all was great.
The guys are kind of reliving a lot of things through me, in a way, just because for me everything's new.
Kelly's very much has a huge part in the design of the artwork, definitely quite vocal about what he wants to see and how he wants the feel to be.
I think you read a lot into albums by the colours of the covers then. If it was a black cover on it or something, it wouldn't be the same thing. And I know that sounds ridiculous, but I think it's true.
I think the new look of the artwork is just bringing something really up to date. It's almost sort of like the album cover that I worked with Kelly on. They've kind of taken that as a reference, and there's a drawing in the new artwork that has the couple kissing, but like, you know, in this age.
We really wanted to do something that nobody would associate with Stereophonics. I didn't even want to put Stereophonics in the album cover, I just wanted it to be Language, Sex, Violence, Other. It is relevant to today's media, I think. You switch on the telly, reality shows, the only bits you're waiting for are the fighting, the shagging, It seems that's the only three things anybody gives about. Or that's the only three things that people tune into anyway. So the other kind of asks, well, surely there's something other than this, you know?
This is a radical departure for them, but I think it's of a piece with what they're saying. Crudely, new drummer, but new look, new sound, new ambitions, new market. You know, the whole thing is saying, OK, that was then, thank you very much, but we want to move into new areas now.
Bands stay fresh and bands stay hungry when they've got a point to prove. They go, right, we're not just this. We're not just what you think we are or what we have been. We're going to make this new record and I really, really want to make it work. It just sounds hungrier.
He's letting something edgier come in. I think to a great extent it works. I think it's a brave album. People love knocking Kelly Jones. And I think when you get to the point where you've knocked someone that long, it's worth actually flipping that over and saying, okay, let's refract it through a different lens now.
First time was ridiculous. You get compared to like Dylan Thomas on the first record and then when people start turning on you, they're kind of like, well, he's always writing from the third person, never writes anything about himself, and then as soon as you do write about yourself, it's like, I wish he'd write about his characters again.
I think if I were to ask him something, I'm sure he'd answer me honestly, but I think when it comes to the press, maybe he's been burned a few times and probably just chooses what he wants to say.
Downside was every journalist in the country thought I was talking about them.
He's the number one poster boy for people sniping at his pragmatism, his ambition, his ruthlessness. He is, in a way, giving the finger to people who are ready to knock him. He's fighting back.
A song like Doorman was much more kind of reminiscent of songs from the first record, you know, quite like something like Too Many Sandwiches, a funny story about a guy on a door kind of throwing us on the street and making a joke of all that situation.
He's got a sense of humour that comes across on a line like that. You're not telling me he's standing in the vocal booth of singing that with a straight face.
A lot of people pick that line up. People can read into it in however they want, whether it is, you know, you suck my banana, suck you with cream. It's just comedy. It's literally for the crack, you know. But it's interesting that every country, everybody's picked that one line out. In Belgium, they thought it was a very big gay double innuendo, which is quite an interesting angle on it as well. It's a lot more lighthearted than the last record. I think the last record was much more of a soul record and a blues record, kind of not spilling your heart, but getting a lot of shit out.
I don't always know how to decipher the songs, but sometimes when Kelly explains to me what a certain song is about, then I go, oh, my God, that's quite hardcore, you know, and it's not always what you think at all. But, yeah, they are very personal.
I kind of laid on the line about my life. And I didn't even realise I did that until the album was complete and I just looked on the board in the studio for all the song titles and I literally could see the last 18 months of my life. and I'd come out the other side sort of thing, which is where you got to go there to come back, the title come from.
Kelly probably is the kind of writer that is quite truthful in the way that he writes.
I might think you got to go there to come back in 10 years' time was completely inappropriate, I don't know. So maybe tomorrow. That's what expression is. That's why people relate to it. That's why you get 90,000 people in the field singing it back to you, because they've all been through the same as you have. We all face the same way. Still it takes all day. Take a look to my left. They got the worst in the I think writing from outside of the songs in the past and then putting myself in the songs now, I don't really know where that crossover came from. It's probably confidence in writing, I suppose.
Although this is quite a big change for them, I think it's really where Kelly's heart is. I can definitely feel it.
I left this record a lot more open to interpretation.
Instead of writing about people that he didn't know at the very start, he's writing about people he does know or has come into contact with. I may be reading far, far too much into those lyrics, but, you know, I'm guessing characters that are in the Stereophonic story.
The last album, their sound was approaching self-parody in the sense that it wasn't pushing itself. It had grown complacent. And I think with something like Dakota, yes, when I first heard it, I thought, who is this? And it's great.
It's great where it comes in the album as well, because you think you've just got a handle on where the record's going and it goes somewhere completely different.
If that song were by Foo Fighters and came on the radio, people would be hailing it as one of the classic rock pop singles of the year.
Where they are now is a long way past, I think, what I thought the Stereophonics would end up doing.
To me, I don't think the band's really got started yet.
This feels right, this feels really good.
It's a new beginning for the band, yeah.
At the moment, we're just having a ball, and the records we're making, I think, are just getting better and better. I'd carry on making records tomorrow. It just takes 18 months to go around the world talking to everybody about it. That's the bit that slows you down.